Hello and thank you for joining. I'm Julianne Bittner. According to my marketing department, I should tell you that I have high energy, intestinal fortitude, and I'm an extremely passionate person who loves to empower staffing owners through education, research, and expertise. It's why I started this podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I want to bring industry experts to the table to discuss issues, challenges, and emerging trends in the staffing industry. Today, I've asked Bob Thompson with Worldwide Specialty Programs to join me. Let me just take a little bit of time to tell you a little bit about Bob. Bob is president of Worldwide Specialty Programs, Inc., now with 25 plus years of staffing industry experience. Bob started as a principal in a marketing firm. His firm focused on market research and analysts of the staffing industry with Worldwide and American International Group as two of his many insurance clients. Bob sold his firm in 2007 and joined Worldwide to run their new business, broker development, and workers' compensation division. At Worldwide Specialty, their business revolves around protecting the staffing industry with sound, customized insurance solutions. In fact, for over 50 years, their sole role has been dedicated to the staffing insurance business, identifying its risk and providing the industry with the most innovative solutions available. They know firsthand the challenges facing today's contract staffing firms and partner with their clients to help build a stronger, more resilient staffing business because of the protection they afford that affords them. Welcome, Bob, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Julianne. That made me sound very important.
Yes, well, good. I'm glad. I always want that to happen. So I see that you are one of the four panelists of the opening keynote session of Staffing Law Conference that's coming up in May, tackling a topic that business owners are struggling with daily, data privacy and cybersecurity. Interesting, great topic. So let's tackle that one. Besides the huge increase the past several years with hacked and breached data, COVID-19, also the pandemic created new inroads to cyber attacks. What have you seen? What steps should business owners be taking or reviewing at this time?
Well, honestly, it's a great question because cyber has become so relevant now with the enormity of social media, people working from home. It's more important now than ever before. It is largely the most requested program and policy that we have.
Wow.
So I would say that we probably get 5, 6, 7 requests a day for it. Mm-hmm. We have over 6,000 staffing firms. So that in itself doesn't seem like a huge number, but when you add that up, you know, hundreds a month are requesting it, yet we only bind a few because people are concerned about the cost. It's not me. I'll never happen. Those things only happen to big IT, you know, big staffing firms. I have an IT department. We're protected. They don't understand. They have a crazy amount of ways to get in. People are opening up emails that they shouldn't, and they're very sneaky. They're good. These guys are good. And they put things out in front, up front of your general employees, and you'd be amazed at what they're clicking, what kind of emails. American Express, Coca-Cola, you know, Marriott, and you want a free trip or your bill is due or whatever it is, and they're clicking on it. The next thing you know, a virus is being sent through the computer. Somebody goes in our business in the staffing world, somebody leaves a computer somewhere by accident. Nothing wasn't an egregious mistake or on purpose, but now we have to notify tens of thousands of people that had that on that computer. So there are hundreds of elements that could go wrong, and most of them are covered by some kind of cyber problem.
Mm-hmm. I was surprised to read recently that they're saying 95% of cyber security breaches are caused by human error, which you're kind of referring to, your staff. That they just make a simple mistake of clicking on a link. Here's a FedEx package that you recently purchased something, click on this link that you track your package or whatever, and it's not really FedEx.
Yeah, well, it's a deceiving number, right? Because yes, that's true. We make mistakes, but the perpetrators, as we'll call them, are very good, very smart, and they're doing things in the instances where like ransomware or or phishing, where they're sending out emails or things like you just mentioned to get people to engage. They're very smart. So it's easy to see people like us, just regular people going through their day, doing in acting and doing things that would really cause this issue. It's hard to be and train everybody. One of the things we try really hard to get is people to practice this. I could give you phishing examples. We send out to our staff. We send out emails on a weekly basis. And then we find out offline, of course, and we say, what's going on here? And we see how many people are actually answering those emails. And we have people even in our business that answer some. Some are really good. Mm-hmm. So there is a lot of human error, whether they're leaving a laptop or ransomware and somebody does something wrong, or somebody says, Julianne, you're on vacation and you authorized a check to go to somebody and they do it when it wasn't really you. And somebody doesn't check the protocols behind it. You're right. There is a lot of human error, but the difficulty is that there's so much being thrown at you. It's hard to be an expert in all of it. Mm-hmm. What you really should have is, and I'll get into this in a little bit, is a plan for this to happen. It most likely is going to happen to you at some point. If it hasn't, it's going to. So mm-hmm. I think one of these chat, you know, one of these phishing emails or people are getting some kind of every 14 seconds is happening, you know, internationally. So there's a lot going on out there, and you really got to be up to speed. And many of the firms that you're addressing that are on this podcast today don't really, I probably would have to admit that they don't really have the protocols in place to prevent those things mm-hmm. or to secure themselves from that. So
exactly.
Because they don't, I see an awful lot of claims, and I really don't think that people believe it's going to happen to them.
I agree with you. I totally do, especially the small staffing firms. They think they're too small for it. But the problem is we're utilizing resources out there that are going to get breached. Clouds, everyone's going to the cloud today, right? And I read a statistic that cloud breaches will be increasing significantly because of that. And then you've got the whole cyber skill gap, the knowledge gap, the skills gap that our staff doesn't understand it. We do the same thing like you do, is we test our staff. We send out test emails to see if they are responding to them so that we can see. And it's constantly happening, so we can re-educate and constantly educate our staff. We also have a phishing email where you think something is phishing, we send it to that email and they check it out for us before we even open up a link, because you just don't know today. It's unbelievable. I don't know if you saw in early March, it was Prism HR, the leading HR and payroll service provider, had a huge breach and they work with over 200 PEOs. So many of our staffing companies work with PEOs. I had three clients affected by that. They shut down their systems for over a week, no processing of payroll, no anything. So you could get impacted. If you think that you're too small or not large enough to be impacted like the big companies that you were talking, Fortune 500s, I think you're misled there. You really have a thought process. You got to go back and go, no, we should look at things. Sending social security numbers and emails. I tell people, don't do that. Don't do it.
People are just flat out. There's two things that I see. One, they're naive to the issue. Mm-hmm. And two, they're not naive, but they don't know what they don't know.
Right.
They're good at their business, but they're not good at cybersecurity.
Right.
So you need to have experts that really can help you here, that can give you, lay out a plan. If a breach does occur, what to do, what vendors to use, what actions to take when that happens. If you're dealing with, say, for me, like a carrier that something happens, you get on that phone immediately. And we have a cyber breach division. We have a cyber breach department that says, we'll do this. We'll tell you exactly what to do. These are the vendors you need. These are the things that you need to do. These are the steps you need to take to minimize this, to minimize the problems. Mm-hmm. The problem is that you need that in advance. Once it happens to you, you can minimize the damage, but it's still damage, right? Mm-hmm. If you know all these things in advance, you can put a program in place, like you put in an HR program or an EPLI program or through some kind of employee handbook, right? A financial program, you use an accountant for a financial program. You use attorneys when you're signing documents and for all your legal activity. But nobody thinks that they should use an expert for the cyber because it's not going to happen to them.
Right.
But it's happening to 65%, 70% of the world right now. Mm-hmm. And the fact that it may have happened to you that you don't even know. Number one, you might have got lucky and missed the, you know, somebody didn't answer that email and that didn't happen, or nobody messed up and let somebody opened up a firewall, or somebody didn't leave a laptop, or you might have escaped the guillotine right now. The flip side of that is sometimes you may not have escaped it, because all the stats show that you could have a breach and not even know for 6 months.
Exactly.
That it happened.
Right. Because they sit in the weeds and they wait. They wait for a long period of time before they actually use that data or that, you know, that information. Right. So
we have great security. Our company, our partners have great security, but we see breaches come into us all the time. We catch a lot of them, but who knows what ones we don't catch. So right. We're constantly training, but we have a plan. We know that if it's preventative, number one, so you try to prevent those things. And if you can't prevent all, knowing that you can't prevent all, you have to have a program that covers you, a cyber program that covers you. And there's a wide variety of them. So you have to know what it is to protect yourself. Mm-hmm. In addition to that, you have clients that are now very savvy, and you're seeing more and more cyber requirements on the contracts. So if the world is going this way, you're better off getting ahead of the curve than behind it. Because right. if you don't, you will be one of the casualties of that. And it could kill your company.
Right. Right. You spoke earlier about costs. Is this an insurance that owners look at as very expensive?
Yeah. When you look at it in comparison to the other lines, like professional liability or general liability or those EPLI employment practices, it is in line with them. But it's, you know, you need PL, professional liability, you know, you need workers' comp, you know, you need GL. That's what you've been taught your whole world in life and business. So those are the givens. Recently, we're seeing a big rush on EPL, right? Mm-hmm. We probably only had 60% of our companies 10 years ago had employment practices. Now, like 98% have them, right? Due to the environment that we're in and social media and the society that mm-hmm. we're living in. So based on the things that happen, you have to adjust and pivot.
Right, right.
And if you don't pivot, you get left behind.
Right.
So now we're seeing almost all have employment practices. And we went from having literally like a 10th of 1% having cyber to about 25% now. Mm-hmm. But honestly, it should be 100%.
Right. And when it's really, the cost is irrelevant once you get a breach, because then the cost is going to, it could be devastating.
You're paying insurance on your home for a fire.
Right.
Right. You pay it every year. Your house never burns down. God forbid, right?
Right.
But you're paying it because you know that if that does happen, or flood or fire, whatever it is, if it does happen, you're protected. It's no different. Mm-hmm. If you get hit, if you have a devastating fire or a flood, you're going to lose everything you have, or potentially, right? Mm-hmm. I had a fire 18 years ago. I lost every single thing that I owned. My house was gone. Every piece of clothing, everything. Thank God I had some protection, right? Mm-hmm. And I didn't have enough. I got pretty beat up through it because I did not have enough, because I didn't know what I should have all the way back mm-hmm. then. Today, you're getting people like us bringing this to you from a cyber standpoint. And this is what's going to happen. And you're going to have the same thing happen to you that happened to me. Mine was fire damage, but yours is going to be cyber. Take heed our warning. It's going to happen and it will come to you. So even if it's a little bit more expensive, you kind of got to just cost of doing business. That's it.
Right. Right. Excellent. Let's move into, you've talked a little bit about, you mentioned it, EPL, Employment Practice Liability Insurance, becoming now, you said, more and more people, staffing owners are purchasing this. What does this policy really cover, this insurance?
Well, you put me in a bad spot here, because I'm going to talk about cyber and EPL. All these things have increased in need and in pricing. Everybody's going to jump out a window after they see this.
Sorry.
So they're all, there's going to be a flurry to open up Chipotle's instead of being in the staffing industry. So EPLI is an employment practices. So all you got to do is turn on TV and realize, turn on whatever channel you look, CNN, Fox, ESPN, whatever it is. Everybody is on it. Since 2016, we've seen four times the amount of claims, four times the amount of jury awards.
Wow.
And what's happening is the juries are having empathy more so than they've ever had before. And these social awards are growing in enormity, right? So God forbid something happens that was a $100,000 claim and payout 4 years ago is now $500,000, $1 million. The numbers are astronomical. So you have to make sure what you're, what the industry is seeing, most people have like a $25,000 deductible. They're paying those $25,000 every time they have a claim. Many carriers are asking them that to go to 50, some 100. States like California, they won't, many carriers won't write anything without a $100,000 deductible on EPLI.
Wow.
So sex discrimination, racial discrimination, you know, somebody comes in and says they don't like your dress, they say you're too short, you're too tall, you're whatever you are racially, it doesn't matter. You're, and especially in this world of COVID, they are, everybody's looking for every single opportunity to hit lotto. And they feel that if they have these things happen, there's huge claims because let's face it, many carriers settle. They settle out. They try to, they don't go all the way through and they try and settle. And we try to tell them, we push to take it to the limit because we don't want to be in a position where we settle. We want to be in a position where if you're doing something wrong, you have to fix it, right? And, but unfortunately, society knows that there's a payout. If you accuse somebody of doing something wrong, there's a payout. The whole system is messed up. But unfortunately, it's not your fault or your client's fault that it's messed up, but it will be their problem if they don't have a robust policy to fix it.
Okay.
Or not to fix it, to fix the result of it.
Okay.
Because so the ripple effect.
COVID-19. So you have a client, you have a temp going out to a client site. COVID-19 could impact you. Is EPL covering that? I mean, different ways it can impact you, not only with testing and vaccination, and but also with what happens if they're, if they do get COVID. So how is the coverage with that with EPLI?
Most pandemic related instances or claims are not covered.
Okay.
So infectious disease, they're generally excluded. So what people are finding is that they're putting a lot of claims in, but they're all being denied because they're in every, a year ago, if you had an infectious disease or pandemic exclusion, you would say, ah, so what?
Right.
It's never going to happen
right.
until that happens, right? And then now it's happened and all of a sudden everybody's clamoring for business interruption insurance, or EPLI insurance, professional liability insurance, and they're putting all these claims in. But the truth is, most of them are uncovered. So, but you do see claims like, they made me go home. That was embarrassing. They embarrassed me. They, I'm now tagged as a somebody that has COVID, or they discriminated against me because they told, you know, maybe the thermometer didn't work when they put it to your forehead, and they said your temperature's too high, and when I turned around up the line to go back to the door, everybody walked away from me like I had the plague, you know? So there are so many things. You people are working in the office and they're told, go home. You can't work here today, right? Well, what happened to Mary? What happened to Steve? They had to leave because why, right? So there's a, an embarrassment factor, which it shouldn't be, of course. But the media has made this thing out to be this crazy, unbelievable thing. Now they're even looking at vaccination cards and all this, this other stuff. It is going to further, in, I feel, it's going to further implode from a privacy standpoint than an EPLI standpoint. You have the right as a human being to say, I want this vaccine or I don't. Some people believe if you want to be in society, you have to make that decision. I'm not taking a stance on it one way or the other. All I'm saying is there are two sides to it. And both sides are going to have EPLI claims. So you better be aware. That's all, as an employer.
Okay, excellent. So anything more that you would want to tell staffing owners with EPLI?
One, make sure you have it. Two, make sure that you have an employee handbook that's robust. I've seen thousands of them. Probably of the thousands, the majority have been inadequate. Some are one pages. I'm sorry about that. Some are one page, two page, three pages. Some are 500 pages. The 500 pages don't get read, and the one, two, and three pages were inadequate. Right. So make sure that you have a reasonable handbook. I don't care if it's 500 pages or 300 pages, as long as they read it, they check off, they sign the bottoms of the pages, they understand that that was, that they observed it, they read it, they understand it, and that if you're going to break these rules or protocols that the company has, you're not going to have a job.
Okay. So one more thing that came up on that, somebody asked me, with the legalization of marijuana impacting in the workplace, is that in that policy, with the EPLI, are you getting some kind of coverage there with that?
I will tell you, you're asking some great questions, because all of these things that you're asking are things that are currently impacting this industry and will impact. And when you have that bell curve, right, you're asking questions right now, Julianne, that are on the bell curve on the way up, and this is the time to grab it. So kudos to you for asking these questions. Marijuana and cannabis is relatively new in the world, not in the world, but in terms of staffing, right?
Right.
Some states have had it for years, but more states are getting it now legal today, right? So you have two issues. One, the fact that more people are going to be in the workplace working, and some with some percentage of them that are high, right? So, or have smoked or gummies or whatever they have at some point. And it's tough enough today to get a full, if you work in a warehouse and you're working an assembly line and you need 100 people to work it, everybody needs more people. Every staffing person on this podcast is saying, how do I get more people to fill all the jobs? There's exactly. Plenty of jobs. I don't have enough. So when you take 15% of them and have to tell them to go home because they failed the drug test, that's not helping the industry, right? Mm-hmm. So you have that part of it. And then the safety part of it of, is somebody really in a condition to work when they are working?
Right.
And what happens from a claim standpoint? Right. So there is data that shows that safety claims have increased because of this. It's just a fact. So you really got to look at it. People in New York didn't worry about it 5 weeks ago. And now all of a sudden they got to worry about it in New York because now it just got passed. And every state's going to get hit with this. Mm-hmm. The rub is that it's still not a federally approved drug, right? Mm-hmm. So there are still complications to it in terms of how you handle it, insurance claims. So the general insurance market has not dealt with, supporting and covering apothecaries or the indoor growing areas, or they just haven't. And they're not going to get on board until it's federally regulated mm-hmm. and it's federally approved. And it's not a federal class one drug anymore. That's not that far down the road, some people feel. So get on it now, understand it now, put it in your handbook now so that it is something. And remember, you as an owner have the right to run a safe environment, a safe workplace. That's your right. So make sure you exercise that right, because if somebody comes in and is, ill-prepared to work or impaired, you do not have to keep them on the job. Mm-hmm. So, but most likely that could be a lawsuit on the way.
Right.
So you did the right thing by your staff. You did the right thing by your client, but you could end up in a lawsuit because mm-hmm.
It's interesting. I get questions all the time. Why don't we fund cannabis? Anybody that's dealing in the cannabis industry. And I said, I can't, because it's not federally approved. So therefore the money, we can't fund it. So it will probably come one day. Who knows? It's another topic we'll cover one in the future, I hope. I hate to bring up the next subject. It'd probably be the third item that you're going to say, Julie, really? Workers' comp, the market. Is it hardening? Are we
seeing? I got to go. I have a call.
I'm feeling like the rates.
Yeah, I got to go, Julia.
What do you want to tell me about the workers' comp market? Well, I think
people are going to walk away from you when they see me at conventions. They're going to walk to the other side of the room.
But they could take steps to help themselves as well in this market.
Yeah. So workers' comp is really a very odd is an odd coverage and policy.
Mm-hmm.
Because most states, their numbers have come down. Their rates have come down. You don't necessarily see that in the staffing industry. So when you're working at a Home Depot, just using it as an example, and John's a forklift driver and he's been in that Home Depot every day for 25 years, he knows the environment. He knows what's going on. Now all of a sudden Bob comes in and he's driving a forklift for the first day. He doesn't know the geography. And now he doesn't know that you got to go a little wider for this turn, or Jim is putting boxes up here on Tuesday mornings and they load this on Thursdays, and you don't know the geography. And what happens is people are getting hurt. So the claims are much higher in the staffing industry, not much, but higher in the staffing industry than some of mainstream businesses, right?
Mm-hmm.
You'll get people that will refute that, but they're wrong. It is higher, unfortunately. So you come in, you see this, you have to fix it. It's fixable. You're able to address it. Make sure that they're educated properly. If they need certification, they're certified. You have your handbooks. You train them. What we're seeing is a lot of, because you can't get enough people, a lot of warm body syndrome.
Right.
We need 60 people to fill an order today. I got 40. We got to find 20. Let's maybe lower our standards.
Mm-hmm.
And they get another 10, which is great, but those 10 aren't really the best to put in.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to really buy in. You have to make sure that your client, critically important, your clients that you bring on board as a staffing firm have to be, they got to buy in. It's got to be safety protocols. They got to believe in it just like you believe in it. And there has to be things in place to make sure that they're a reasonably secure and safe environment before you put your people in there.
Mm-hmm.
Because claims are rising. You're seeing it all over, not just workers' comp, not just general liability, not just EPL, the whole country, not just staffing, the whole country. Premiums are rising, claims are rising. Look out your window. We've had riots. We may have more. We've had horrible weather. We may have more. You've had destruction. You may have more. Every day in the paper, somebody else is getting accused of something else. Everybody's getting hurt. They're cutting corners. People are working from home. You can cover your office, right? You walk in, get out of the elevator, you come into your hallway, you get in your office, you go to your desk. You know that environment. Now people are working from home. What kid left a toy on the rug, or the dog's in the middle of the carpet, or they had to do something, or somebody rang the bell and you tripped over a wire because you don't really have an office. You're kind of in your living room, kitchen, handling everything with your computer because you weren't really ready to work from home. So there's a lot of nuances that are happening that the insurance world is just not really ready for, and they are getting ready, but that means that you're going to see increased premiums, and it's going to happen, unfortunately.
So can we leave on a high, any good notes today?
Happy Easter. Happy Easter. Let's go back.
Happy summer. Summer's coming.
Happy summer. Yeah. It's 63 degrees here in New York. Let's leave on that note.
Yeah. We pushed it your way from the Midwest because we went down now. We just got done. But good news is we're going to start seeing conferences in person. So that'll be great. We'll start to be in person again as
that
we
be awesome.
In the corner of this pandemic, we hope so.
Yeah. Well, everybody's been trying to be good citizens, and that's great. And, I don't know. There's a lot of fear out there still, but a lot of vaccines are happening. So that's great.
Yeah.
So I think that once all this happens and people start getting regular again, and the fear isn't so predominant in everybody's mind, that people will start to get back to work. And I don't know if they're all going to go back to their offices. Everybody seems to have adapted to working from home.
Right.
But we'll see how this thing plays out. But either way, all the things that you brought to light today are very important, home or at work. So your clients and everybody that's going to be listening to this should be really proud of you for what you're doing, because these are tough topics. You don't always want to hear them. Mm-hmm. You don't want to get somebody like me that comes on and says these things, but the best thing you can do is listen to somebody like one of your experts and giving you a heads up so that you understand it before it hits the fan for you.
Right.
And that's your job. That's what you're trying to do. Give everybody a heads up before it hits the fan. So right. Good job. And I appreciate the tough questions, and hopefully I answer them as well as I could.
You did a great job. I appreciate it. Thank you for the kind words. And it's always great to talk with you and have you, your insight in all of this, and insurance industry itself is remarkable. So we appreciate what you're doing, what Worldwide is doing for the staffing industry. You guys are a huge partner to the staffing industry, and we all appreciate it. So thank you.
Well, good. I'm here. And if any of your clients need to talk about a personal instance or something like that, I don't mean personal instance, you know, I'm not a good therapist. But if they have issues at work or issues that they have some confusion on, whether they're our clients or not, you just have them call me and I'll try to get some feedback for them.
Sounds great, Bob. Well, thank you for your time today. I know you're a busy man, so thank you. I appreciate you slotting this time into your schedule. You take care. We will see you
very well.
Soon. Bye-bye.